Let's say you're visiting Earth for the first time, and the tour of the planet consists of being dropped into random locations for about 5 seconds before being whisked away to an entirely different spot on the globe. If you knew nothing whatsoever about life on Earth, how might you interpret what you saw? At first, these narrow glimpses of a vast world would be confusing, and probably a little bizarre. But over time, as the brief snapshots formed a greater whole, you might be able to get a sense of broader patterns of life here on Earth. Exobiotica is a speculative biology project by incredible artist Michael Beaudry that offers similarly limited windows into the sprawling alien biosphere of a planet called Veteris. In the words of the artist, each composition is a tip of an iceberg, a momentary and fleeting glimpse into an entire ecosystem. And the lifeforms we can document are uniquely alien, even by the standards of speculative biology. Yet the more art you observe, the more you begin to understand the larger stories of life upon planet Veteris. So, for this entry into the archive, we'll shine a light on the secrets of each region and uncover how the larger ecosystems fit together. And as always, you can follow and support the artist using the links in the description. Now, let's set off towards planet Veteris and prepare for our first glimpse of this world of mysteries. Planet Veteris lies beyond the outskirts of a stunning nebula. The very name Veteris gives us some understanding of the nature of this world, as it means ancient in Latin. And indeed, this planet is quite old relative to Earth, at almost 8 billion years. Since this is nearly twice the age of our home planet, there's no telling what life has emerged. Time for a closer look. Touching down on Veteris, our first glimpse of the teeming surface is difficult to comprehend. At a glance, it's hard to tell which of these organisms are plants and which are animals. On Earth, broad categories like plants, animals, and fungi are useful in the classification of lifeforms, and it's rare that one would mistake one for the other. But the lifeforms on Veteris resist such classifications entirely, and many remain unnamed. The large, plodding walkers in this image move like animals, yet they can photosynthesize. The flower-like lifeforms might look like plants, but they can walk on their spindly legs. The long, rope-like organisms that carpet the ground can't walk, but do grow at a rapid pace to mark their territory. Even the rock-like spheres are secretly alert, employing an electrochemical defense to keep the creeping tendrils at bay. The end result is an ecosystem with extreme biodiversity that is truly difficult for us Earthlings to comprehend. But the more locations we visit, the more we'll understand. The twisting matrix of tendrils define a region known as the low forest, and here we'll discover another unusual organism roaming amidst the strands. This is a dachia, a generalist hunter that walks upon three flexible hydraulic legs, which are powered by pressurized liquid. An organism powering their legs with hydraulics might sound like pure sci-fi, yet surprisingly, many types of arachnids actually use pressurized liquid to help power their spindly legs. And since Veteris' gravity is lesser than Earth's, we'll find many organisms get around on similar hydraulic tubes. Aside from its locomotive limbs, the dachia possesses small grasping appendages to help it apprehend prey and communicate with other members of its species. For the dachia is a fairly clever and naturally curious lifeform, which can sometimes lead it into trouble. For the most part, dachias stick to the low forest when searching for food. In our next snapshot, however, we can see a dachia standing at the threshold of a very different kind of environment. An organic cave marks the entrance to the otherwise sealed glow forest. Encouraged by the prospect of shelter, the dachia considers entering the dark yet inviting refuge. But what will it find inside? Entering another snapshot, we can see that within the glow forest, a mysterious ecosystem awaits. Since this region possesses such a thick canopy, virtually no light reaches the lifeforms that dwell within. As a result, these organisms have evolved a startling array of bioluminescent displays. On Earth, surreal pageants of bioluminescence can be found throughout the depths of the oceans. These remarkable spectacles of light are thought to serve a variety of functions, from communicating to attracting prey to warding off predators. And in the Glow Forest, the mysterious displays are equally diverse. This particular organism possesses glowing bands on its back, likely to attract a mate. The vibrant colors and slug-like locomotive appendages of this lifeform call to mind certain genera of marine gastropods. And with a sharp, stinger-like protrusion on its front end, this doesn't seem like a particularly friendly customer. Closer to the forest floor, vertical glowing bulbs sprout from the ground in vast quantities. The vibrant light they're emitting indicates these bulbs are on the cusp of reproducing, but they might never get the chance, for they are under siege by a slow-moving, yet ever-hungry behemoth, a Laterna pulmonis. Although a placid and rather unintelligent sort of fellow, this organism is nonetheless a serious threat to the glowing bulbs. Like its food source, the Laterna pulmonis possesses purple bioluminescence, which helps it blend into the surrounding forest. So unless a very sharp-eyed predator comes along, the Laterna pulmonis will likely continue snacking. In the murky ponds on the floor of the Glow Forest, we can glimpse a surprisingly diverse community of organisms that thrive in these cloudy pools. A miniature forest of towering colonial microorganisms dominates the landscape, feeding off methane gas released by decaying organic matter. Upon this bedrock of the food chain, a plethora of creatures creep and crawl about their daily lives. On our planet, similar dramas unfold in coastal rock pools. And while these pools might seem peaceful, they are actually battlegrounds for survival. Predators like the starfish are constantly on the prowl, and in turn, they are sometimes swallowed up by certain sea anemones, which grow large enough to consume almost anything in the pool. And on Veteris, a similarly ravenous Goliath terrorizes the murky ponds. In the distance, the pond's top predator rises above the towers, a mysterious and shadowy leviathan that devours everything in its path. Other creatures need to keep their distance. Far from the dimness of the Glow Forest, our next snapshot brings us to the vast plains. Here, we can see a group of spindly lifeforms called the Magna Vindex engaging in a very intriguing behavior. These imposing creatures, which stand around 15 feet, or 4 meters in height, are shepherds of sorts, keeping watch over their unusual flock. They spend their days herding the placid, defenseless lumentis that are their main source of food. On Earth, several species of ants are known to engage in a similar behavior. These ants are herding aphids, small rotund insects that excrete a sugary liquid that the ants feed on. In exchange, the ants go to great lengths to care for their wards, protecting them from predators, carrying them to new pasture lands to feed, and even encouraging them to reproduce. And the Magna Vindex are similarly involved in the lives of the lumentis, playing the role of both defender and matchmaker, bringing pairs of lumentis together when their biolights signal they're ready to mate. Indeed, this symbiosis has grown to the point where the lumentis have no conception of danger, and are free to grow heavy and slow as they graze upon the expanse of fibrous purple organisms that dominate this land. Looking through another window, on Veteris, it seems symbiosis has emerged in other unexpected formulations. This spherical lifeform is a round walker, and while it might not look particularly mobile, it does, in fact, amble slowly on its long, spindly legs. At the moment, this particular round walker is beleaguered by a flock of flat parasites clinging to its surface. Yet the round walker isn't bothered, for its surface is tended to by a spiny little fellow called a guardian. Like their name suggests, guardians are the defenders of the round walkers, as well as their cleaning service, and in exchange, the round walkers serve as their living, mobile homes. This mutualistic symbiosis has converged on a partnership similar to that of sea anemones and clownfish. Certain anemones rely on clownfish heavily, as clownfish both keep the anemones clean, provide nutrients in the form of waste, and scare off any would-be pillagers. In return, the anemone's tentacles provide a safe home for the tiny clownfish. The guardians and round walkers are similarly linked, to the point where you'll never find either species on their own. And so, the round walkers amble along, each crowned by a spiny guardian defending their small world. But not all organisms are so harmonious. Deep within a forested valley, a familiar arms race has emerged in some very unfamiliar lifeforms. Here, a predatory creature called the Voloxos follows its hunting path by the river. It's a capable hunter, with three powerful hydraulic legs and a harpoon-like proboscis, which extends almost the full length of its body. And this Voloxos has spotted its prey, a dish-faced centipede that has emerged from the undergrowth for a drink. The centipede's appearance helps it blend in among inactive lifeforms on the forest floor, much like how Earth's Bargabont seahorses have evolved to almost perfectly resemble the sessile stalks of coral. But like the specialized seahorse, the centipede's camouflage only works for specific environments. And in this light, it's dangerously exposed. Moments from now, an intense chase will begin between predator and prey. No matter which species triumphs, the perpetual theater of natural selection will continue across the planet. Natural selection doesn't just breed competition on land, however. Our next glimpse shows us a scene below the waves of this alien world. Here, the quick and nimble sea swifts jet along the currents, sporting long lateral spikes to keep predators at bay. Spikes are a common defense in the natural world, with certain types of marine gastropods having converged on similar lateral defenses. Near the spiky sea swifts, the more vulnerable bubble swimmers drift along. These filter feeders use wave-like ripples in their translucent outer membrane to propel themselves slowly through the current. Both the sea swifts and the bubble swimmers are on their own in these vast oceans. But other species have partnered up. The glass coligadio is a composite organism, a creature composed of multiple species that share critical biological processes between them. In the glass coligadio's case, the larger swimmer provides mobility, while its multi-legged symbiote feeds more effectively than it could alone. As discussed before on this channel, numerous organisms on Earth are also comprised of multiple lifeforms working in tandem to survive. Yet curiously, interdependence between two separate species appears far more common on Veteris than on Earth, a trend that will only strengthen the more lifeforms we observe. Near the surface of this world's oceans, one can, on rare occasions, catch a glimpse of a bizarre display. An entourage of deep-sea behemoths are making a brief ascent to the surface, releasing gelatinous strings of embryos here in the sunlight where their young will have better visibility upon hatching. While a lifeform blindly releasing huge clouds of their children into the wild might sound like a bad strategy, it mirrors that of many lifeforms on Earth. In general, there are two main reproductive strategies on our planet. Organisms that are K-strategists produce fewer young, but place a greater investment into each, ensuring a higher percentage of their children reach adulthood. But there are also R-strategists, which flood the ecosystem with progeny so that regardless of how many don't make it, at least some are likely to survive long enough to reproduce. While the behemoths are clearly R-strategists, their children won't be completely on their own. A swarm of intrigued lifeforms tail behind the behemoths, and will become unwitting hosts for their multitudinous offspring. The embryos will stick to and develop upon the surface of these surrogate species, until they're ready to hatch and repeat the cycle. Luckily for the host species, however, they won't suffer any ill effects from their temporary parasites. In the murky blackness of the deep sea, many creatures use bioluminescence similar to the lifeforms of the glow forest. The amusingly named gullible vagari wander the depths looking for the matching biolight of another member of its species. Described as a hopeless romantic, whether the vagari's search ends in success or tragedy is a matter of fate. For there is a dangerous predator skulking in the abyss. The giant Alysio is an organism that has evolved bioluminescent appendages that mimic the light of the vagari, its main food source, and lure them into its jaws. This low-energy hunting method has resulted in a cumbersome lifeform that isn't particularly hydrodynamic. On Earth, the lumpy frogfish have a similarly ungainly body plan due to a convergent lifestyle. Like the giant Alysio, the frogfish baits its prey with a specialized lure on the front of its head. After all, when your food comes to you, you don't have to be particularly mobile. Back on land, a lifeform known as the Sunworshipper leads a placid and cautious existence high above the ground. Like many other mobile creatures on Veteris, the Sunworshipper receives a portion of its energy from photosynthesis, as evidenced by the specially adapted appendages radiating from its body. To stay safe, the Sunworshipper has evolved eye spots on its appendages, which give predators the impression of a much more formidable opponent. This sort of defensive mimicry is convergent with that of various Earth prey animals, perhaps most notably the eye spots on the wings of certain types of butterflies. For a creature that wants to stay hidden, the coloration of the Sunworshipper might seem strange or even gaudy by our terrestrial standards, but in its native habitat, the bright red serves as excellent camouflage. And in a world as extreme as Veteris, it pays to blend in. Our second to last glimpse at planet Veteris is one of the most striking. Here, the ruler of a misty valley watches as a competitor makes their approach. These lifeforms are greater confo, highly territorial organisms that do battle with a set of forward-facing hydraulic spears. This disputed territory is a surreal landscape of fluid-filled branching growths called camsenas, a type of photosynthetic lifeform analogous to trees. And this biome has hidden dangers. The glowing orange gel that coats the forest floor is tasty and extremely sticky, designed to ensnare hungry lifeforms that will later be consumed. Overhead, a flock of bicolor mycans have noticed this accumulation, and are flying en masse to take advantage of it, but doing so carefully, for even a creature as large as the invading confo might become trapped if it's not vigilant. And in our last image, we can see a scene where seasonal rains have blessed an arid region. Here, desert runners, lifeforms with now familiar tripodal body plans, congregate for a drink. But the allure of water has drawn in another organism as well, the unparalleled monolith. These living towers send thick tendrils towards the shallow pools to drink their fill. The monolith may only get the chance to drink in this way two or three times a year, but it's enough to keep the structure alive during drier periods. And along the surface of the monolith, glowing biolights shimmer in the setting sun. These points of light are signals to the nocks that soar nearby, flyers that roost within the monolith during the day, and in return provide the structure with discarded food. Each nox can actually recognize the unique pattern of biolights on their home monolith out of the crowd of others. This final example of symbiosis may have been a surprise at the beginning of our journey, but now it's just another familiar expression of planet Veteris' broader patterns. Like an alien witnessing Earth's splendor in brief snapshots, our understanding of planet Veteris will always be somewhat limited, but now we've observed enough moments across the planet's surface to understand many of its fascinating systems. It's been a unique viewing experience, and there may be more to come. According to the creator, the larger Exobiotica project will eventually cover other planets beyond the world of Veteris that will harbor entirely new forms of life. But for now, if you enjoyed discovering the secrets of Michael Beaudry's incredible compositions, you can once again follow and support the artist to see more exciting illustrations using the links in the description. And as always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.